Joining us on Hot Copy this morning, Chairman of the Senate Committee on Basic Education, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. Senator Gatchalian, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to our televiewers.
All right, that was a heartbreaking report by Shara Zambrano, essentially just giving us a picture of what the first day was like. So I'll start with something like this. Is this sustainable?
We have to go back to the basics, no? And the basics here is making sure that our children have the modules that they can follow and use to learn. And another basic is for our teachers to be equipped to assess the student and also to make other modules or other devices for them to gauge the student if they are learning or not. Mm-mm. In this manner, it's sustainable. No? Mm. But then again, Karen, yesterday I also went around to see the experience of our teachers, their experience of our students, and the modules can only do as far. No? The modules is very basic. And yesterday I went to a grade 10 student and they were teaching fractions, they were teaching mathematics. It's very difficult to absorb all of these complicated subjects without the assistance of a teacher or without any visual assistance. Mm-hmm. And this is where the TV, this is where streaming comes in. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that's why I cannot claim complete victory yesterday, mm-hmm. because if you look at from a standpoint of parents and teachers, the lack of internet connectivity became the stumbling block. A lot of LGUs, like in Valenzuela, we launched our own streaming school, but without internet connectivity, it's very difficult to deliver that all the way to the homes of our constituents. So mm-hmm. I can only say it's a partial victory insofar as class opening is concerned. Mm-hmm. The telco should step up. It's now in the hands of our telcos to step up and to make sure that connectivity is available to all of our students.
Mm-mm. So you don't agree with Secretary Briones's description yesterday, declaring victory over COVID-19. She said the destroyer of our lives, the economy, way of life, and society. You only describe it as a partial victory yesterday. Other than internet service, what other challenges did you encounter?
Insofar as DepEd doing their utmost effort to open classes, I have to commend them for doing that. It's a challenge. No? We're looking at 23 million students, teaching 23 million students, equipping 900,000 teachers and non-teaching staff with the necessary tools to pursue class opening. And this is really a big challenge. And the 1.5 month class postponement helped make our divisions and our schools prepare much better. Mm-hmm. But having said that, again, we have to use all tools available. And I'm looking at the point of view of our parents and their students. Mm-hmm. And I've seen firsthand that connectivity is a problem. And this is an eye-opener for us moving forward. Because if you want to step into the new normal or the better normal, we have to improve connectivity. Uh-oh. So my point of the matter here is the next challenge will be next year. In fact, I'm looking at 2021 already, because in the absence of a vaccine, then we have to continue this type of modality. And this is a challenge also. And the stress level for teachers is very high. Now, just imagine if you're handling 40 students, you have to check on them 40 different times every single day, whether they're learning, they're online, or they're doing their homework. And that's also quite stressful. Especially coming next year.
Okay, so let's talk about that first before we go into the modules. Internet connectivity, the problem number one. Ngayon, mahina ang signal. You're asking telcos to step up. But the other issue is, frankly, it's expensive.
Yes, another is cost. No, and that's a function of competition. I was hoping that the third telco will be online at this point. But then again, the NTC can look at their the charges that they're charging our students, or the partnership that they're forging with DepEd. This is another issue. In the Bayanihan law, we inserted 4 billion pesos for gadgets and also to support our teachers with connectivity. But then again, this is not enough to cover everyone. So that's why we go back to the basics, the modules. The modules is the device or the handout that our students will have, all of our students will have, and this will enable them to at least follow step by step. Mm-hmm. Another important component, Karen, is the TV and the radio broadcast. No? Okay. And yesterday it already started. And we have to make sure that this broadcast is communicated properly, because I also detected some students don't know what time grade 10 or what time this subject will come out. So the broadcast is a very important tool for student to be able for the student to follow their subjects and learn.
Okay. Another thing, balikan ko lang yung gadgets. You said 4 billion was set aside. The truth of the matter is, if you have a class of 40, and we know this, Senator Wynn, is you can only view 49 at a time, if I'm correct, via Zoom, if you're using a high-end laptop, right?
Correct. We have to use the most popular tools and the most available tools. Like in Valenzuela, when we surveyed, we use Facebook Live, no? Because we detected that almost 90% of our parents have Facebook Live. So we said we will set up a streaming school and we will stream all our lessons. The problem, Karen, is out of the 10,000 students per class, only 7,000 logged on. So the 3,000 were missing. And we found out that the 3,000 either didn't have, like you're right, no, didn't have the money to buy connectivity. The other ones didn't have gadgets. And this is where my worry comes in, because even within their public school system, there's inequality. Yeah. Those who are in the middle class can buy gadgets, can have connectivity, but those in the lower class will be left behind. And this is where we have to address it. And that's why I also call on the hearts of our LGUs to look at our constituents who don't have this type of entitlements.
Now, the backup solution that the DepEd prepared for, of course, is modules. And the DepEd said 13 million students out of the 22 million are using printed modules this year. This is 667.7 million printed learning modules. Is this worth something like 30 plus billion, Senator Wynn? How much was spent this year for the modules, and for 2021, how much will be spent?
We estimated the modules, no, for the entire country will cost approximately about 3 billion a month. No, so for that, for a 10-month school year, will cost approximately more or less about 30 billion. For this year, it's already covered, no, because DepEd downloaded approximately 10 billion, and we only have 2.5 months left before the end of the year. That's why next year I said it's a challenge, because if ever a vaccine will not be discovered and we will remain with this type of distance learning, then we have to again print all of those modules and again spend for all of those gadgets.
Okay. So now, why are newly printed modules important? Why can't students use books that have already been printed, that have been printed or published for their grade level?
Okay, that can also be used, no, the books. But the modules is designed for self-learning. No? That's why it's called SLMs, no? Self-learning modules. It's designed to be used by a student. And if the student follows it step by step, he will learn by himself. No? Much like the ones in college. No? If you have in college, you have online learning and you can actually learn by yourself. This is designed that way. The textbooks are not designed that way. The textbooks are designed for face-to-face learning. So this is where the difference come in. But you can also use textbook. No, if the principal or the division school superintendent has a way to use the textbook, then they can also use that. But it's prescribed that the modules will be the methodology or the content that will be used.
Okay. Now, what's interesting, before I move on to the challenges of modules, Secretary Briones said that this is expensive and frankly, in the long run, has a big effect on the environment. And she did say, kumbaga, maiiwan ang ating mga estudyante, considering ang Southeast Asian nations, napakabilis ng internet, naka-online learning yung ating mga kapitbahay.
Unfortunately, it's true, Karen, but we don't have any choice right now because not everyone has a laptop or a device. And going back to my experience yesterday, some of them have only one cell phone for three kids. Naghihiraman sila the whole day, no, because the parent only has one cell phone. And that's reality, no? So in order to launch this distance learning, you have to go back to the basics, and the modules is the basics. It's not environmentally sustainable, because yesterday nakita ko one module for this year was approximately about almost 1,000 pages per student. And imagine, multiply that by 23 million students, no, times 8 subjects. Mm-hmm. So that's a lot of printed materials. Mm-hmm. And that's a revelation for all of us, no, that in the future, we need to use blended learning, online mm-hmm. learning mm-hmm. as part of our learning and education. Uh-oh. So that we can transition as fast as we can in times of this type of pandemic.
So is this the right model for us? I think, you know, going fully online is perfect when you are a country with great internet and you're a country that's very middle class. All your students can afford their own gadgets. Medyo also the capability of the student, they can do things on their own. But is this the right model for us? We are seeing other countries, Senator Wynn, where you do have students coming into school. It's a smaller class size. Some countries I'm seeing there's parang acrylic in between the students. I've had parents ask me, could there have been some innovative way, not just this way?
Karen, initially, you know, I had this thought of probably opening up 30% of the capacity of our schools in mm-hmm. low-risk areas.
Yeah.
But if you have news reports such as the one that happened just recently this weekend in Batanes was COVID-free for 6 months, mm. and just this weekend they had 2 COVID cases. Mm. So the situation is very volatile. One day you don't have cases, next day you don't have cases. You have cases, and you don't want a scenario wherein you have face-to-face classes and then you retract it and then you have face-to-face classes. It's more disruptive that way. Mm. So for now, this is the best we can do, no? But I strongly suggest that we should also look at other modalities in low-risk areas. For example, the roving teachers or the roving tutors. In low-risk areas, they can already conduct small groups, for example, groups of 5 students, group of 10 students, that the teacher will go there. Instead of the students going into the school, it's the teacher that goes there, supports them with tutoring, supports them with learning and interaction. Because a lot of the students also yearn for interaction because they've been trapped in their houses for the last 6 months. So this is a modality that we can explore slowly in low-risk areas.
I wanted to ask you that, no, because if it's a low-risk area, for example, wherein there is no COVID in that particular town, Senator Wynn, no, and we know even the WHO encourages that you should be outdoor. Right? In fact, doctors encourage that when the air conditioner is on, you have a window open. So let's say there's a teacher, 5 students, and you teach under a tree, or eto ka na nasa covered court, pero 1 meter apart kayo with your face mask and shield. Do you see that as a doable option?
I think so. For example, here in Metro Manila, we don't have so many trees anymore, no, in our communities. But they can have, let's say, in the daycare center, because daycare centers are located in the community, or for example, in somebody's house na medyo maluwag, and people can have, again, no, 5 to 10 students. As long as you practice social distancing, you have enough space, it's open air, and the teacher goes there, or the tutor, or the roving teacher goes there. That's feasible, and I think that can happen sooner than the new year, because from what we are experiencing right now, those students will not have any form of visual teaching or someone teaching them visually. Mm-hmm. So very, very difficult. And that's why I again emphasize on the TV. You know, the TV is one intervention that will be very important, especially to those who don't have access to gadgets.
Okay, but do you agree that one size fits all in terms of learning under COVID doesn't work? Because Congressman Pantaleon Alvarez, he was on this show, and that's one of the things he criticized about the IATF. He said he didn't agree that the education solution was coming from a national level down.
The way DepEd approached this distance learning is what they call contextualization. Mm. No? So meaning whatever is feasible in your location, depending on the risk implemented. No? For example, in some areas, they will implement like in our area, streaming schools, and then we have the modules. In some areas, they have cable. So it depends on your area. But the general rule there is
you're not allowed to go out there. That's the problem.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's no face-to-face yet. No, there's no face-to-face yet. But I think after a month of this school opening, then we will assess. We have to assess whether the kids are learning. If the kids are not absorbing, then we have to do another innovation. And the next innovation that we're thinking of, and actually I'm suggesting to DepEd, is that roving teacher that can go around the communities and teach small batches of students.
Okay, the roving teacher is quite interesting. Let's just expound on that a bit because it just might happen, right? Okay, the roving teacher, alam naman natin in a public school, Senator, one teacher handles a class, let's say, of 40 or 45, unlike private schools where maybe they'll have a maximum of 25 to 30. Pag 40 to 45, how would you then deal with that? Kasi you would want a maximum of maybe 5 to 6 o kahit nga 10 na wag lang magkakadikit. But how would you make the teacher go around and how many hours should a student be out?
Karen, actually this idea is not unique. No? In the US, they call it learning pods. Mm. Wherein they create pods and the teacher go there and they teach the community. No? Okay. So it's pretty much the same concept. So in this case, if you have 40 students, you can teach 10 students at a time, depending on the location.
No. So you create four pods.
You create four pods, correct. You create four pods, and the last day, you can do your assignments, you can grade them, you can do the assessment. So this is pretty much a structure that we can do for a student. And this can go all the way to grade 12. Grade 12 are independent learners. They don't have to be coached on a regular basis. So they can all be coached probably an hour a day or probably 2 hours a day, as long as they have interaction with the teacher. But for grade 4 and below, you need regular interaction. And that's where the roving teacher or the roving tutor comes in.
Okay. Now, back to the self-learning module first. Is one of the biggest challenges with the COVID pandemic, not just in the Philippines, but all over the world, is now parents, right? Parents are also partly teaching their kids at home, even if they're online or there's a self-learning module. But that's on the assumption that the parent is educated herself or himself. Alam naman po natin dito sa Pilipinas, marami po tayong mga magulang na hindi po nakapagtapos, Senator Win. So, 'di ba, ang pangarap nila yung anak nila ay yun ang makakapagtapos. Ang mahirap yung sinabi niyo, fractions, algebra. Eh, hindi po matutulungan minsan ng magulang yun. Math is a big struggle at home.
Correct, Karen. In fact, yesterday I had a call from the Visayas and the complaints of the teacher there because that's Visayas primarily a fishing area. Yung mga mangingisda natin, they only finish up to grade 1, some up to only grade 4 or grade 5. And they're required to teach their kids who are in grade 4 or grade 5 or grade 6. And the subjects are very complicated. And frankly speaking, Karen, yesterday when I was holding the book of the grade 10 and looking at their mathematics, a lot of them we forgot already. No? Even us in government, a lot of us forgot all of those complex subjects. This is where the teacher comes in.
Yeah.
And that's why part of the program is for the teacher to reach out to the student and to reach out to the teacher. It will be a proactive role. Before, it's the student going to the school, but now it's the teacher going out and looking for that student who will require extra assistance and require extra attention. And it's very challenging. That's why our teachers will be in a lot of stress because they'll be monitoring the student, they'll be printing the modules, they'll be typing the modules themselves. And at the end, they have to assess whether the students is in fact learning or not.
Now, there's a lot of expectation on the teacher. And just recently, Senator Win, you called that teachers shouldn't be burnt out, diba? Sinabi mo to avoid multitasking. But what benefits are there for teachers? You asked for a review of the Magna Carta for Public School Teachers, or RA 4670. All right, let's discuss this in detail, Senator Gatchalian. So much is expected of our public school teachers, but are we giving what the law provides? Let's talk about that. For example, you pointed out the law provides free and compulsory medical examination before they take up teaching. So my question is, pag ang teacher po ba nagka-COVID, lumalabas siya, roving teacher, great idea. Will the government guarantee that the teacher will have absolutely no expense, the best medical care in a private hospital, public hospital in the Philippines? Eh, alam natin, sir, ang COVID can reach 1.5 million.
Karen, our teachers are frontliners in education. Mm-hmm. Sila yung lalabas, no? And mm-hmm. they will be the ones exposed to the communities and to our barangays. Mm. And we have to make sure that they have the confidence that if something happens to them, the government is there behind them, making sure that they have testing, they have treatment, all the way to helping their families. Without that, they will not have the confidence to do their jobs, no? Because this is a very risky job at this point. And initially, I have to admit, initially, DepEd didn't focus on this, no? In fact, that was the major complaint of our teachers, because the teachers were not given that the medical support in case that they will be hit by COVID. Yeah. But in also fairness to DepEd has already came up with a mechanism for teachers to use in case that they will be hit by COVID. PhilHealth is there. As government employees, such as myself and teachers,
yes,
we're all required to be part of PhilHealth. But you also have to make sure that PhilHealth will give them quick attention, because frontliners nga sila. Mm-mm. And DepEd has already managed to fix that process, that in cases of teachers, teachers getting COVID, they will be given attention right away by PhilHealth and also by DepEd themselves.
Pero can you guarantee, sir, na libre? I mean, kung ako po, frankly, public school teacher, I love your idea of being a roving teacher. Pero gusto ko, sabi ni Senator Gatchalian, dapat pag nagka-COVID ako, libre, walang gastos.
Dapat libre, no? And PhilHealth, libre yun, no? That is something that we are pressuring DepEd to make sure that our teachers are taken care of, especially in testing, treatment also, and also hospitalization if they will be hospitalized. Okay. And as far as PhilHealth contributions and PhilHealth benefits, it should be free.
Okay. Now, in terms of testing, that's quite interesting. If you want them to become roving teachers, then it means the government will have to set aside, frankly, every 2 weeks, either money for swab antigen, because that would be faster, but that's an additional amount on the budget.
Correct, correct. And that's how we have to live by with this virus. In fact, testing is now part of our daily lives as we go by with this virus.
Yeah.
As individuals, because we want to go back to work. And if we are out of our homes, then the risk goes high. And that is what government is now preparing to make sure that our teachers have continuous testing. The testing is part of the program of DepEd, but you're absolutely correct. It cannot be only one time, because they'll be exposed. So it's something that we're working with DepEd to make sure that there's sustainable testing and also treatment if our teachers get exposed.
Okay. Now, Senator Wynn, the Magna Carta for Public School Teachers also mandates that teachers will not render more than 6 hours of actual classroom teaching in a day. So this is very tricky because we live in extraordinary times. Paano po ito, Senator?
Correct. No, actually, this is the prescribed working hours, because alam naman natin, our teachers don't only teach. They prepare the examination, they check the assignments, and in normal cases, they look at the health. No, they look at may deworming pa yan, meron pang mental. Sometimes some of our teachers practice mental health support.
Ba-o.
And they work more than 10 hours, frankly speaking, a day. No, so but again, no, that's why I give a lot of thanks and appreciation to our teachers. Even it's in the Magna Carta, they go out of their way to make sure that the student, that our children, gets the best possible education and the best possible attention. Okay. And I have to give credit to our teachers.
I'm just going to rush this because I heard that you have a meeting. You're only available until 8:30, Senator, so you have to forgive me. So I know you want certain benefits added for public school teachers with this setup. Senator Kiko Pangilinan wants the 3,500 yearly chalk allowance to be used for internet service. Anything else you can add? Does that mean that's a given already?
I think right now what we have to support our teachers with are things that can they use to deliver learning and education of high quality. And what are those? Gadgets, data plan, and also load. No? Ito lang naman request nila. In fact, that's their basic request, because without all of this, then it's very difficult for them to deliver education. And that's what we placed in Bayanihan too. And that's what we are now assuring, that that 4 billion that we placed in Bayanihan will be given as a support to our teachers.
All right. Well, on that note, Senator Gatchalian, thank you so much for your time this morning. So one thing clear is you're going to assess after a month, and then if it's very difficult in certain areas in the Philippines, you're going to suggest the roving teacher method. Correct.
And as we speak, DepEd is already exploring that. They're coming out with guidelines, of course, working with IATF and DOH. But that's a good small step in order to reach out to our students.
All right. On that note, stay safe, sir, and you stay strong. Take care.
Thank you, Karen. Stay safe.